Bismillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear brothers and my sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa. I received a question in the group which goes this way. What is the ruling on touching the mushaf, i.e. the Quran, when women are on their menstrual circle? Is it true that our difference of opinions? My daughter has been told at madrasa, when she is on her monthly period, that she can touch the mushaf as long as it is the edge and not the Arabic. I have also heard you are totally forbidden to touch it completely. I have also heard it is okay. My daughter had to read the mushaf daily as she is trying to memorize, and I have concern around her touching it. So there you go. The question here really is a very, very interesting one and important one. What is the true ruling about this issue of a menstruating woman touching Al-Quran? Sadly so, this topic of a woman or a girl going through their periods and their ability to touch, hold or read the Quran has been traveling with us for over 14 centuries. It is really unbelievable, my brothers and my sisters, how scholars dealt with this feminine issue. At first, the issue was merely an opinion. Everybody of the Sahaba knew exactly what they had to do when a woman was menstruating and to read Al-Quran. However, when the different fiqh schools and opinions were formed, it no longer became seeking the truth. It became rather more, my opinion is correct and yours is wrong. And since my school of thought said this or that, I will stick by my school of thought regardless of what the evidence that you can provide. Strangely enough, this feminine topic was never dealt by female scholar, but rather more by male scholars who sadly always and still today consider the female gender a source of fitna. And by fitna, I mean temptation, attraction, enticement, and seduction. That's how it is looked at, unfortunately, in our books of fiqh. And since women did not have anything or anyone to defend them into the court of the fiqh, the male gender took it upon themselves to render this issue to its highest and most unbelievable levels. They did almost everything, our scholars in Islam, knowingly or unknowingly, to render this issue to the worst it can get, from making a woman wear a glove to turn in the pages of the Quran, or to turn them with a stick of wood, or not to touch the letters and just go to the edges, and to the far extreme opinion, not for a woman to be in the same room as the Quran. And sadly so, many people count these acts as an act of piety. When you look at this issue from this angle, you think, Ya Allah, how difficult this matter is. But truly, is Islam a religion of hardship, or is it the opposite? Well, actually, as it turns out, Al-Islam is not hardship. It never was and never will. But the billion-dollar question is, then why do some of our scholars who claim true fellowship of Islam insist on making things harder with an endless list of halal matters that turned into an evil haram today? They thought that by restricting people, they would make them better Muslims. And that is a huge mistake. It is really mind-wrecking to see scholars who have appointed themselves as protectors of Islam and associated themselves as the followers of the Salaf, the predecessors. And what they did was really, it's my way or the highway, and they turned away from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded in Al-Quran, that this religion is a religion, and Islam is a religion of easiness, din yusr. What they did is, they always indoctrinated us that being a good Muslim, we must always be sad, scared of Allah, think about the grave, spend time in the masjid, always reading the Quran, always making the tasbih, while the scholars and the rulers and everyone else are doing as they please, while the rest of us and the population remain oppressed, poor, and controlled. Look how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has labeled this religion. وَمَا جَعَلَ عَلَيْكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ مِنْ حَرَجٍ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not placed upon you in this religion of Islam, the deen, any difficulty. This ayah was faithfully and beautifully, totally implemented by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this hadith reported to us by our beloved mother Aisha radiallahu anha in Sahih al-Bukhari, when she beautifully said, ما خير رسول الله بين أمرين, wherever Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had to choose between two matters, إلا أخذ أيسرهما, except that he took or chose the easiest, ما لم يكن إثما, as long as it is not a sin. فإن كان إثما, and if it were a sin, كان أبعد الناس منه, he was the farthest person from it. And this hadith, as I mentioned earlier, is in Al-Bukhari and Muslim. So as you can see, if Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was given the option between picking, a woman should pick a mushaf when she has her menses or not, he would have gone for her picking it up. But why is it then that so many, a huge number, the majority of scholars believe that a woman must not touch the Quran? So where did that come from? Well, as it turns out, this long-traveling, contradictory and confusing topic came about because of an understanding of an ayah in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, let's start with the Qur'an, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Waqi'ah, إِنَّهُ لَقُرْآنٌ كَرِيمٌ. It is a precious Qur'an. فِي كِتَابٍ مَكْنُونَ. In a well-protected book. لَا يَمَثُّهُ إِلَّا الْمُطَهَّرُونَ. None touch it except the purified. تَنْزِيلٌ مِّن رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Revealed from the Lord of the worlds. The argument here is that لَا يَمَثُّهُ إِلَّا الْمُطَهَّرُونَ. None touch it except the purified. Well, in English, purified, but it could be purified. But in Arabic, الْمُطَهَّرُونَ is completely different than الْمُتَطَهِّرُونَ. From the whole of the group of this ayat, it is clear that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about Al-Quran, he was on about the book that is in Al-Lawh Al-Mahfuz, the preserved tablet, because that's where the angels are. But the best one to explain this to us is going to be Ibn Qayyim Al-Jawziyyah alayhi rahmatullah. I'm going just to report the text in English. If you want the Arabic text, I've got them here. So please bear with me as this is the translation of what he said in Arabic. Number one, he said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala referred to the book as maknoon, and maknoon means kept away from the eyes of onlookers. And as you can tell, the angels do not look, and also humans can't see what the angels hold. Number two, when he says, لا يمسه إلا المطهرون, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the angels and not humans, because if he meant humans, he would have called them المتطهرون. As in, al-mutatahirun is different, those who purify themselves is different than al-mutahharun, those the purified. So, mutatahir is you do the purification to yourself. Al-mutahhar, Allah has done the purification or someone else has done the purification to them. Just like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says when we finish the wudu, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ التَّوَّابِينَ وَالْمُتَطَهِّرِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves those who repent to Him, and He loves those who purify themselves, i.e. in doing the ghusl, taking shower, and making the wudu. Number three, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reporting here is a fact, not a command. It's just Allah telling us what it is. It's not like, don't touch it until you get purified. If this were a negative command, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would have said, لَا يَمْسَسَ, is not to be touched. Number four, these few ayat are to nullify any thoughts, because some people, they said that the Quran is brought by the shayateen, the shaitans. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, no, this book is in kitabin maknoon, and the shaitan cannot reach the high-placed and well-kept book. Number five, this ayah resembles the one in Surah Abbas, fi suhufin mukarramah, in honored sheets or pages, marfu'atin mutahhara, exalted and purified, بأيدي سفرة, in the hands of angels, كرام بررة, noble and very dutiful. Also, Surah Al-Waqi'ah was revealed in Mecca. And as we all know, the Quran that was revealed in Mecca in the first 13 years didn't have any commands to it. And Surah Al-Waqi'ah was wholeheartedly and fully revealed in Mecca. And as such, it doesn't have any commands. Another argument that they use in the prohibition of a woman touching the Quran is a weak argument, and that is about the Islam of Umar radiallahu anhu. As we all know, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu embraced Islam in the year 6. And the story has it that Umar ibn al-Khattab, they say, decided to go and kill Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. On his way there, he found a man and he told him, "Ya Umar, where are you going?" He goes, "I'm going to kill Muhammad." Then the man said, "Why?" He said, "Because he has caused us a lot of headaches in Mecca." Then the man said, "Well, if you are going to do that, you better go to your sister's house because she has embraced Islam." And the story has it that Umar radiallahu anhu goes there and he hears his sister reading the Quran. He walks in and she tells him, "You cannot touch the Quran because you are najis, you are not mutahhar." And they say that Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu went and took a bath and then he went and read the Quran. And as I already mentioned before, Umar ibn al-Khattab did not embrace Islam like this. And the whole story is a weak. Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani alayhi rahmatullah says that this, in the meaning in English obviously, that this hadith has many issues with its chain of narrators. And that is how he said it in Talkhis al-Habir. Al-Imam al-Zahabi alayhi rahmatullah and others including al-Albani alayhi rahmatullah said that this story is totally rejected. So as you can tell here, we cannot use this totally rejected story as an argument to not touch the Quran. Their third argument is they say that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had written a message to Amr ibn Hazm, who was sent to Al-Yemen at that time. There, Al-Yemen people were not all of them Muslim. They were just a small, tiny minority. And they say, as the hadith reported by Imam Malik and An-Nasa'i and many others' books, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, "Allah yamassa al-Qur'an illa tahir," that the Qur'an cannot be touched except by a tahir. Tahir is a purified. This hadith has been debated in between the scholars in regards to its authenticity and acceptance as an evidence. Some qualified this hadith as weak, such as Ibn Hajar alayhi rahmatullah in Talkhis al-Habir and Al-Imam al-Nawawi in Al-Majmu'. Both of these great scholars have deemed this hadith as weak. And Ibn Hajar is the great guy who commented on Sahih al-Bukhari and Al-Imam al-Nawawi about Sahih Muslim. However, Sheikh al-Albani alayhi rahmatullah, after studying it further, found out that it could probably maybe be raised to the status of good, because this hadith has been reported by different venues and all of these hadith could stand for each other. And he reported this in Irwa al-Ghalil. However, the scholar said, even if the argument's sake, this hadith was accepted as an evidence. But the term tahir has got many meanings. It could be purity of the heart from disbelief. It could also mean the purity of the body, like you take a shower or you take a bath. It could also mean purity of the clothing and the place. It could also mean the purity of you when you make the wudu. And as such, they said that there is a fiqh rule which says, "الدليلُ إذا تطرق إليه الاحتمال بطل به الاستدلال." The evidence which has or is prone to different interpretation and meanings can no longer be used as a proof. And here, purified could have any meaning. And as such, we cannot just pinpoint it to one single meaning. As we can see here, the arguments that they have used so far do not hold true. The fourth argument that they use, that the woman cannot touch the Quran, is another hadith reported by Hakim ibn Hizam, where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in it, "لا تمس القرآن إلا وأنت طاهر." Do not touch the Quran except that you are pure. And this hadith is reported by Imam al-Hakim and Ad-Darqutni and At-Tabarani. However, Imam al-Haythami alayhi rahmatullah said that the chain of narrators of this hadith contained a man called Suwayd ibn Hatim, and who has been weakened by Al-Imam al-Nasa'i, a great scholar of hadith, and also by Ibn Ma'in, another great scholar of hadith. And so did Abu Zar'a, also another expert in al-Isnad, in the chain of narrators. Also, Al-Imam al-Tabarani and Ibn Hajar alayhi rahmatullah classified Suwayd ibn Hatim as unreliable and weak. So as you can see here, the hadith itself here is not accepted at all and is rejected. Ibn Hazm alayhi rahmatullah went on to the other end extreme and said that the prohibition of touching the Quran doesn't have any authentic text to support it. And he said this in Al-Muhalla alayhi rahmatullah. So to this point here, we have mentioned all the evidences used by scholars who prohibit or people who prohibit the touching of Al-Quran by a menstruating woman. So now let's look at the evidences for the permissibility that it is allowed to touch the Quran. Number one is the evidence that there is a huge lack on supporting of evidences that prohibit the touching of Al-Quran. And this is, as I explained already and clearly mentioned, but someone might say then it is safer to just say it's not permitted and rid the world from this issue. For example, what I'm trying to say here is that since we can touch it, why not don't we all agree not to touch it? And end of it, why do we have these arguments and these differences and things like that? Well, this argument is entirely against the beauty of Islam that has clearly emphasized that everything and anything on earth is halal unless clearly and without any shadow of doubt can be proven haram or not permitted. But if there is any doubt, no matter how little it is, then the rule of al-aslu fil ashya' al-hil aw al-ibaha illa bidalilin sarih, i.e. the root of the matter or the truth of the matter is anything on earth is halal unless there is an evidence that prohibits it. End of it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clearly made this clear in Al-Quran when he says subhanahu wa ta'ala, قُلْ مَنْ حَرَّمَ زِينَةَ اللَّهِ الَّتِي أَخْرَجَ لِعِبَادِهِ وَالطَّيِّبَاتِ مِنَ الرِّزْقِ. Say, who has made haram the beauties or an adornment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala which he has brought out, i.e. created for the people, and also the goodies and lawful things from provision, i.e. who has the authority to forbid things when neither Allah nor Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the authentic sunnah that doesn't contradict Al-Quran hasn't prohibited the matter. Therefore, touching of the Quran by a menstruating woman remains permissible until proven differently. And the good news is there are no authentic supporting evidences for its prohibition. Number two, the believer is not impure, dead or alive. Subhanallah al-Haq. Al-Bukhari and Muslim alayhi rahmatullah have reported in their authentic books a hadith reported by Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu in which he says, أَنَّ النَّبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ لَقِيَهُ فِي بَعْضِ طَرِيقِ الْمَدِينَةِ, that the Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم met Abu Huraira in one of the streets of Al-Madinah. وَهُوَ جُنُبْ, i.e. Abu Huraira had the janaba, he was not impure. He had either wet dream or he slept with his wife, but he didn't wash himself. He didn't take the bath. فَانْخَنَسْتُ مِنَهُ, i.e. I pulled away and hid myself from Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم so that he doesn't speak to him, he doesn't see him. And then he went, فَذَهَبْتُ فَاخْتَسَلْ, then Abu Huraira said that he went home and made a ghusl. ثُمَّ جِئْتُ, then he came to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم and Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم told him, أَيْنَ كُنْتَ يَا أَبَا هُرَيْرَةَ, where have you been, يَا أَبَا هُرَيْرَةَ. Then Abu Huraira told him, يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صلى الله عليه وسلم, كُنْتُ جُنُبًا فَكَرِهْتُ أَنْ أُجَالِسُكَ وَأَنَا لَا غَيْرِ طَهَارَةَ. I had the janaba, I had, again, I was not pure from wet dream or sexual intercourse or whatever, and I disliked sitting with you, not being pure, tahir. Then Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said to him, Subhanallah, إِنَّ الْمُؤْمِنْ لَا يَنْجُسْ, the Muslim, the believer, doesn't become impure, doesn't become najis. And this, actually, the purification is here is about the spiritual. Yes, the body, we take a shower, we take everything, but when it comes to our spiritual, our belief, we do not become impure. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, إِنَّ الْمُشْرِكِينَ نَجَسٌ فَلَا يَقْرَبُوا الْمَسْجِدَ الْحَرَامِ بَعْدَ عَامِهِمْ هَذَا. So the non-believers, they are najas, they are an impurity in their belief, so let them not come close to Balad al-Haram, ayah al-Kaaba, from their this year of theirs. So as you can see here, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made it explicitly clear to Abu Huraira and to us that even a Muslim in the state of janaba, due to intercourse or wet dream, he is still a pure. Number three, hand me the prayer mat. Aisha radiallahu anha, our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, said, قال لي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said to me, ناوليني الخمرة من المسجد, i.e. hand me over the prayer mat from the masjid. And this is an evidence that you can pray on a prayer mat. قالت, she said, فقلت إني حائض, I am menstruating. Then Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم told her, إن حيضتك ليست في يدك, your menstruation is not in your hand. فناولته, so I hand him, so she went to the masjid and she gave him the prayer mat. And this hadith is in Sahih Muslim, An-Nasa'i, Ibn Majah and Abu Dawud. So as you can see here, so where does this prohibition actually come from? Where did our scholars come up that a woman cannot touch the Quran, or if she does it with a stick and she doesn't be in the room and all these things? Actually, the big surprise, it comes from the Jewish religion. You'll be surprised. Let's hear Dr. Reverend Israel Slotky in his book, Introduction to the Tractate Nidda. Nidda is N-I-D-D-A-H, is the menstruating woman in Hebrew. He says, the Old Testament stipulates a woman is unclean during menstruation, but the Talmud, which is the book of the Jewish, stipulates her period of uncleanness lasts for an additional week after menstruation has ended. What this means is when a Jewish woman menstruates, for example, a week, even if, for example, it stops today, for a whole other week, the lady is considered unclean, impure, for another 7 days. And the nidda, as I already said, is the word used to denote the menstruating woman and her period of uncleanliness. Let me tell you something. In the Jewish religion, the nidda, or the menstruating woman, defiles everyone and everything she touches. She may not have sexual intercourse with her husband. If she does, he is subject to arrest and perhaps the death of penalty. And this is what is reported in the Old Testament in Leviticus chapter 15, verses 20 to 22, King James Version. It reads this way. It's scary. Look at that. Number 20, and everything that lies upon in her separation shall be unclean. Everything also that she sits upon shall be unclean. SubhanAllah. Number 21, and whosoever touches her bed shall wash his clothes and bathe himself in water and be unclean until the even. And whosoever touches anything that she sat upon shall wash his clothes and bathe himself in water and be unclean until the even. Therefore, my dear brothers and my sisters, according to the Old Testament, a woman has to be isolated during her monthly period, and she contaminates all who she touches, including her husband, kids, and everything, and they also become unclean. Look at the following again from Leviticus chapter 15. And if it be on her bed or on anything whereon she sits, when he touches her, i.e. the husband, he shall become unclean until the even. And if any man lie with her at all, her husband, and her flowers be upon him, he shall be unclean 7 days. And all the bed where she lies or he lies shall also be unclean. It's unbelievable. It really is. As you can see here, again, Leviticus 15, verse 29 and 30 orders that at the end of her period, the woman must give 2 pigeons and 2 turtles to the priest so he can slaughter them. Listen to this. Verse 29. And on the 8th day, she shall take unto her 2 turtles or 2 young pigeons and bring them unto the priest to the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. 30, verse 30. And the priest shall offer the one for a sin offering and the other for a burnt offering. And the priest shall make an atonement for her before the Lord for the issue of her uncleanliness. Leviticus chapter 15, verse 29, 30, King James Version. In the Jewish encyclopedia, my dear brothers and my sisters, a woman is unclean for 7 days only. But during this time, her defilement is communicated to every object which she comes in contact. How does this all relate to our Islam? Remember in Al-Madina, the Jews lived close to the Muslims. There was a daily interaction and no problem. And the Jews used to tell the religion, da'wah, whatever, to the Arabs. Our mother Aisha, radiallahu anha, so many ahadith, has learned so many things in the Jewish teller stuff. Our mother Aisha, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told her to give him the prayer mat from the masjid, when she told him, I have my menses, reason being, because she heard from the Jews that when a woman is menstruating, she becomes impure, and anything she touches becomes impure. This is why she said to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I can't give it to you. But Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told her, but your menstruation is not in your hands. And hence, Al-Islam nullifies and breaks down this issue of the Jewish law that when a woman menstruates, she becomes impure, and anything she touches becomes impure. Look at how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala beautified the religion of the Jews if they had followed Al-Islam. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has explicitly said that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, الَّذِينَ يَتَّبِعُونَ الرَّسُولَ النَّبِيَّ الْأُمِّيِّ. Those who follow the message, the prophet who is ummi. They translate into the unlettered, the uneducated, whatever. But al-ummi has got a far more beautiful meaning, and it's not the time here to explain that. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, الَّذِي يَجِدُونَهُ مَكْتُوبًا عِنْدَهُمْ فِي التَّوْرَاتِ وَالْإِنْجِيلِ. Whom, i.e. the prophet, they find written on what they have written in the Torah and the Gospel. What does this prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam does? يَأْمُرُهُمْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَاهُمْ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. He commands them to do good and righteous and forbids them what is wrong. And وَيُحَرِّمُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْخَبَائِثِ. He makes unlawful for them evil. وَيَضَعُ عَنْهُمْ إِصْرَهُمْ وَالْأَغْلَالَ الَّتِي كَانَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ. And he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, puts down the burdens and the shackles which were upon them. And the burdens and the shackles is exactly what the law of Musa had. As you've heard, that women become impure and anything they touch becomes impure. Now, the million-dollar question is, can you touch the Quran when you're menstruating or not? And the beautiful answer is, yes, you can touch Al-Quran when you have your menstruation. You can carry the whole book, turn the pages, and read it, memorize it, touch the writing, do whatever you want to do. Al-Imam Al-Albani alayhi rahmatullah says, in the translation of the meaning, he said, لا نجد في الكتاب ولا في السنة ما يدل على منع الحائض والجنب من مس القرآن أو تلاوته. We do not find in Al-Kitab, i.e. the Book of Allah, nor in the authentic Sunnah, what points or what prohibits the menstruating person or al-junub, the person who has wet dream or sexual intercourse, that they cannot touch al-Quran or reading it. بل لعلنا نجد من القواعد والأصول ما يدل على خلاف ذلك. But perhaps we find in the laws and rules of our religion that which points to the opposite, i.e. you can touch it. And he pinpoints to that fiqh rule, al-asr fi al-ashya al-ibaha, the matter as its originality or the origins of any matter is that it is permitted. And then he said, فَلَمْسُ الْقُرْآنُ وَقِرَاءَتَهُ فَأَكُلُّ مِنَ الْأَمْرَيْنِ الْأَصْرُ فِي ذَلِكَ الْإِبَاحَ. So he said that touching al-Qur'an and reading in it remains in its root, that yes, you can do that, until and endless. There is an evidence that prohibits us from doing that. This is not only the argument of Sheikh Al-Albani alayhi rahmatullah. Al-Imam Ibn Taymiyyah alayhi rahmatullah is of that opinion. Al-Imam Malik alayhi rahmatullah is on that opinion. Al-Imam Ahmad wa Shafi alayhi rahmatullah are also on that opinion. Now, some of the people, they say, well, Rasulullah didn't read Al-Quran when he was junub. Again, this is an argument refuted by Al-Albani, Ibn Taymiyyah, Imam Ahmad, Malik, and Shafi, that you can read Al-Quran and carry the book anytime, anywhere you want to, and there is nothing wrong with that. Even Ibn Taymiyyah alayhi rahmatullah said, if the lady is memorizing Al-Quran and she is scared of forgetting it, then it becomes wajib, obligatory on her to carry the book and read from it. My final thoughts and closing statement about this issue of a menstruating woman, can she touch the Quran or not? My dear brothers and my sisters, it is clear that the Jewish tradition has rubbed on our understanding of what a menstruation person can and cannot touch. As such, asking a woman not to touch the Quran is more of a Jewish practice rather than Islamic. And here is my closing statement from the great scholars such as Ibn Taymiyyah, Al-Imam Malik, Ahmed, Al-Shafi'i, and of recent Al-Imam Al-Albani, just you can touch Al-Quran, read from it, and there is absolutely nothing wrong at all. You don't need a stick, you don't need to wear gloves, because as Rasulullah ﷺ said, your menstruation is not in your hands. I actually can't understand that some scholars would command a woman not to look in the book of Allah for 7 days. What for? What for? It's just because we touch the writing of a Mus'haf? Now, do we just like, because it's ink, it becomes haram? This is the Jewish tradition. Because a woman in the Judaism, when she has her menstruation, she is unclean. The clothes she wears are unclean. Where she sits is unclean. If anyone touches her, becomes unclean. If her husband sleeps with her or has intercourse, he is arrested with a pain, with a very huge probability of death penalty. Many of our rulings, unfortunately, have got some Judaism in them, and I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us clear our case and make us better Muslim. So final statement, my sisters, no problems at all in touching Al-Quran while you are menstruating, reading from it, touching it, holding it, and all that stuff. Even if you are not menstruating, you had a wet dream or sexual intercourse, and you touch the Quran, you read from it, that's fine. Some people, they go, if you are studying, you can touch the Quran, but if you want to read it as an act of worship, you don't. So Jewish-like worship. Forget it. Do as you please with Al-Quran. It's the beauty of Islam. ما جعل عليكم في الدين من حرج. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not made in this beautiful Al-Islam any difficulty for us. Some people have the knack of turning things into hardship, and in the day of Al-Qiyamah, Allah will hold them responsible to that. This is your brother, Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa. To join my group, just send me a message on 078-7640-8735. If you have any questions, any comments, any discussions, anything, please do get in touch. وصلي اللهم على نبينا محمد سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. And Allah knows more. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.